All right. I know Prehistoric Planet came out a couple of months ago already at this point, but I'm finally a bit more on track with my schedule. This episode looked like something I was really going to enjoy watching. It's probably not just me either. It feels like it's very rare to see dinosaurs depicted in cold, snowy climate conditions. While I'm thinking about it, the YouTuber Dead Sound has a really great series that I would absolutely recommend. And I will also have that video linked in the description below. Alright, here we go. Episode 4, Ice Worlds. The episode starts off with a gorgeous dromaeosaur cuddled up in the snow. We learn from the narrator that this is set in the North Pole region. Up here, the dinosaurs must endure months and months of darkness. In a place of such extreme weather conditions, it's really good to see the dromaeosaur here with a beautiful full coat of feathers. The attention to detail in the feathering on some of these animals is very impressive. And then we also go back to the notion that they were possibly pack hunters as well, working together to bring down more prey. As I've mentioned in a previous episode, I'm not particularly for or against this behavior. I do think it's interesting that this is the third time, actually, that they've shown this pack behavior. So, in order for the pack to cause a little bit of chaos, the three of them work together to bring down a hadrosaur. A herd of them is currently trying to cross a dangerous icy river. Everything was going fine until the dromaeosaur showed up. And panic ensues. In the rush of everything, we see a small infant hadrosaur get trapped in the water. I thought this was a beautifully well-shot scene, as we watch the mother try to help the baby, but ultimately she's powerless. But, as luck would have it, it survives. Although the specific species of this hadrosaur goes unnamed, I do want to take a moment and also appreciate the design of this one. The stripe pattern and the scales look fantastic in my opinion. And of course, while the baby survives, the dromaeosaurs still get a meal at the end of it. Also, if you take a look at this scene, there is this very funny thing that I had completely missed my first watch. As the hadrosaurs are about to cross the river, you'll notice by a boulder there's a very toy-like dinosaur right there. It blends in really well, so I actually think a lot of people missed it. So yeah, just a cute little Easter egg there for ya. Up next, we're going to take another look at some other bird-like dinosaurs. This one is specifically Ornithomimus, translating to bird mimic. We get to see a large group of males trying to impress females through their nest building skills. Not too dissimilar to birds today, is it? I'm honestly in love with the feathering that we have on the male. Something about that little pompadour is so cute and precious to me. Also love getting to see the steel and red combination. I love these big fuzzy ostriches. The nest building can get really competitive among the males. Some of them even go as far to steal. Well, actually, all of them steal from each other. Something about watching these sneaky males creep up and take things from the others, it really just reminds me of my flock of chickens. My opinion is if you love dinosaurs, you should absolutely get chickens. Alright, enough of that. Up next, we've got more hadrosaur herds on the move. This one is specifically named to be Olorotitan, giant swan. I'm instantly in love with the crest design, both in color as well as the structure. Speculation is that the hollow head crest would help them with vocalizing, maybe made honky noises. But before this segment even really starts, I think I'm getting a bit burnt out on these hadrosaur herds moving from one place to another. I don't know, it's a silly nitpick, but that's just kind of where I am by the time we get to episode 4. Anyways, we see them migrating towards an active volcano. This is due to the fact that the warm volcanic sand is great for baby making. And gosh, these little guys are so precious. I sure hope none of them die later. Unfortunately for the Olorotitans, they aren't the only ones who are prospering in this volcano valley. Their biggest threat here is actually mosquitoes. Trust me, you don't want anything to do with any big-ass bug from the Cretaceous period. No thank you. There is also an extremely unfortunate moment in this part where a baby is quite literally covered head to toe in mosquitoes, almost guaranteeing death. The hadrosaurs begin to evacuate, and luckily this baby also survives, so... Up next, it looks like the warm air of the volcanic alley made violent lightning storms appear, triggering a forest fire. Now, I like this next segment a lot because we get to see Troodontid. This Troodontid isn't running from the fire, it's spreading it. Did you know that there's some animals we've seen intentionally spreading forest fires by wielding a burning stick? Yeah, it's kind of crazy actually. The Troodontid in this episode is able to take advantage of the flames by frightening smaller creatures. We even get to see it catch an unnamed mammal. I absolutely adore this shot of the flames dancing in its eyes. One criticism, though, is that I do wish that they named what mammal that was. That is also something I've come to notice now that we're on the fourth episode. I just end up asking questions, and unfortunately the documentary is not answering them. But to give it a little bit more praise, I'm also very interested in this design of the Troodontid. I like how the feathers on top are not quite a mohawk, but it's pretty close. After the arson segment, we're then taken to see a group of three young Antarctopelta. Their name alone tells us we're in the Antarctic now. I'm going to guess that general audiences watching this won't be as familiar with dinosaurs from the southern hemisphere, so it's really exciting to see that maybe this will become someone's new favorite dinosaur. We get to watch them journey together, searching for a new home. They start sleeping in caves together, but as they get older, they unfortunately don't fit. So we see a single male journey on his own, and there's these gorgeous glowing fungi. The light they're producing attracts bugs to them. I definitely want to give props for how beautiful this cave segment was. And the design of Antarctopelta is also very nice. However, there's something weird about the eyes for me. I didn't enjoy this segment as much since the eyes just looked oddly human in some moments to me. I don't know, something about that just really threw me off for this segment, but the rest of the design of them is fine. And to end the episode, we're taken to a herd of Pachyrhinosaurus. I instantly need to appreciate the design of the scales, from the coloring to the spacing. I also love that they gave them the eyes of certain herd animals, and I really also appreciate the speculation they did for their horn ornamentation. You'll even notice that they have these quill-like feathers on their bodies, both on their tails and backs. Honestly, I think this depiction looks stunning. The animals hear the approach of a predator, Nanuqsaurus. We get to see another fantastic display of an animal with both feathers on its body as well as scales. Also, I really appreciate seeing lips on dinosaurs. That might sound odd, but trust me, it's nice to see. And just get a load of that thick coat he's got on. And not only that, they're also depicted as hunting together in a pack. I would also like to note, this is a small relative of T-Rex. If you haven't seen my previous episode about T-Rex and feathers, I would definitely recommend watching it after this episode. The herd of Pachyrhinosaurus tries to hold off the predators for as long as they can, but ultimately, the group of Nanuqsaurus are successful. I thought this segment was a great way to end the episode. I absolutely loved the designs of both of those dinosaurs, and I also loved getting to see more predator-prey action. Thank you guys for watching part 4 of my series. I'd love to know what your favorite part of the episode was, or maybe you had something that was your least favorite. Feel free to comment down below, And maybe consider giving this video a like if you learned anything new. Thank you so much again for watching this, and I'll see you guys next time.